recap at how labrum looks. Labrum is seen as triangular, well-marginated, hypo-intense structures because they are fibrocartilage, they are dark on all the sequences. They should be sharply marginated like this. The anterior and the posterior labrum we evaluate on the axial images, while the superior and the inferior labrum we evaluate on the coronal images. Sagittal images, we'll use it to corroborate what we are seeing on these images, but not as a primary sequence to look for labral pathologies. Because you may not always get the glenoid in this fashion showing the entire labrum in one section. Now, when we describe labral tears, how do we describe it? So there's the clock method, but the problem there is 9 o'clock and 3 o'clock. In each shoulder, it will be opposite. Some people take 3 o'clock as anterior labrum, no matter how, which shoulder it is. Like for example, here it's really coming at 9, but you're calling it as 3 o'clock. While some people in this shoulder, they'll call the anterior labrum as 9 o'clock and posterior labrum as 3 o'clock. That leads to confusion. So the best way is to talk about quadrants and the clock together. So this is the superior labrum, posterior inferior labrum, anterior inferior and anterior superior. So for example, I may see there's a tear involving entire anterior labrum extending across 12 o'clock into the posterior labrum up to the posterior equator. So that gives a surgeon the extent of the labral tear. When I look at the labrum, so this red is the labrum, it's firmly attached to the underlying bone. There is periosteum, which is very firmly attached to the underlying glenoid. When there is a Bankart lesion, what we call as a fibrous Bankart lesion or a cartilaginous Bankart lesion, the labrum is completely torn from the glenoid attachment, the anterior inferior labrum, and the periosteum is also disrupted. How do we see it on MR? You can see clearly this is the normal posterior labrum, and here there is anterior inferior discrete labral tear. On these coronal images, again, the anterior inferior labral tear is seen well. Another example, normal posterior inferior labrum. You can clearly see the anterior inferior labral tear with the periosteum getting disrupted here. Sagittal image is showing you the entire labral tear very well. Or face appearance from about 3 o'clock to 6 o'clock is the labral tear. Now, if the dislocation has happened with more of an impaction, like for example, in Bankart lesion, you kicked the door and the door came off at the hinges. But here, you have kicked the door so hard that a part of the wall also has come off. And that is a bony Bankart, where along with the labrum, a piece of the glenoid bone itself has come out. So non-fat saturated images like T1 or PD will show you the bony Bankart lesion, the osseous fragment very well. You can clearly see. So if you use T2 fat sat, there's a lot of edema and that confuses things. But non-fat sat sequence, either T1 or PD, will show you this osseous fragment when you want to give its dimensions and whether it is displaced significantly. This is a bony Bankart lesion. Sometimes you may have a tear, but the labrum is torn, but the periosteum remains intact, as we can see here. And that is a Perthes lesion. How do we see it on MR? Again, in my practice, we do not do arthrograms for last about 10 to 15 years. We have not done arthrograms because with 3T imaging and as well as 1.5T, this in fact is a 1.5T image, reducing the FOV, increasing the matrix, decreasing the slice thickness gives you very good resolution images and you don't need an arthrogram. So clearly here, normal posterior labrum, and here you can see anterior inferior labral tear with the periosteum intact. You can see this periosteum intact here. This is a Perthes lesion. Does it really matter to the surgeon whether it is Perthes or Bankart's? Not really. They want to know whether the labrum is torn or not. Then management would not differ too much between these. Sometimes the periosteum is intact, labrum is torn, and then the labrum has got displaced medially. This is known as ALPSA, anterior labral periosteal sleeve avulsion. If you can't remember the name, no big deal. You can say that anterior inferior labral tear with the torn labrum with intact periosteum displaced medially. So that becomes an ALPSA lesion, as you can see here. importance of this is these need to be operated earlier. Otherwise, they kind of heal with scarring in this kind of an abnormal position, which you do not want. Then the prognosis, if you do surgery later, may not be that good. Along with the labrum, if a part of the hyaline articular cartilage has come off, that's glenoid labral articular defect. But if you just call it labral tear, anterior inferior labral tear with a small adjoining cartilage defect, that would mean the same. Again, here you can see labral tear and a cartilage defect. So hyaline cartilage looks intermediate signal intensity, while fibrocartilage looks dark. And here is a cartilage defect. So again, this, the important point being, the prognosis may be a little bad as compared to the other pathologies.